Colm? Are you coming out to the pub, Colm?
The Banshees of Inisherin is about two friends on an island off the coast of the west of Ireland. It's sort of, in a way, a vague third part of that sort of island trilogy. Plays of mine, the Lieutenant of Inishmore and the Cripple of Inishmore.
Is Colm not with you?
No.
Colm's always with you.
I know.
Did you not knock for him?
I did knock for him.
Well, where is he?
He's just sitting there.
Sitting there doing what?
Sitting there doing nothing.
Lifelong friends, and one of them just simply doesn't want to be friends with the other one anymore.
If I've done something to you, just tell me what I've done to you. And if I said something to you, maybe I said something when I was drunk and I've forgotten it, but I don't think I said something when I was drunk and I've forgotten it.
I just don't like you no more.
We proceed through the damage done when one good friend falls out with another, and it becomes a tale of destruction.
You do like me.
I don't.
Reset.
What made me want to do it was that the project came to me from Martin McDonagh straight. That's the entire truth.
I mean, before you heard it. Oh, no.
Not the first person to say this. He's an extraordinary writer. It's really quite common knowledge. Anyone who knows of his work, people in the industry, lovers of theatre, critics of theatre and film, he's recognised as one of the most extraordinary voices in theatre and in cinema now.
It's hard to find scripts that are moving and make people think about how they think, and he always seems to do that.
What the hell's going on with you, me feckin' brother?
Don't come in here shouting the odds at me in the middle of the feckin' day, all right, Siobhán?
You can't just all of a sudden stop being friends with a fella.
Why can't I?
And isn't that the purpose of art? You want art to make people think deeper.
What's the feckin' matter then?
He's dull, Siobhán.
What, he's what?
He's dull.
I wanted to write something about two friends and a fallout for a while. It kind of all fell into place pretty quickly once I started. I wrote the script of this about 3 years ago. It's probably my quickest between finishing a script and getting it made.
There is a community of actors that Martin likes to work with again and again. He's very comfortable in that company, which is a thing from theatre as much as anything else.
I wanted to get Colin and Brendan back together ever since in Bruges, really, because they're lovely guys to work with anyway and brilliant. But there was something about us together on in Bruges that we didn't want it to be a one-hit wonder.
What Martin does is he writes with that latitude inbuilt, so that he'll write the characters where there is room to explore and to find things out within the process.
And that's one of the things I love about Martin's writing, is that it lacks malice. Some of the characters can be incredibly malicious and incredibly cruel, but I never detect any maliciousness from the writer, from the creator of it.
It was definitely written for them. They're great actors. They always want to explore the truth without hiding any of its ugliness, without shielding us from how dark these characters might be.
There's that idea of coming with the heart on your sleeve. You know, we both let our guard down quite a lot, and I think myself and Colin trust each other fundamentally in that regard.
What are you doing?
I don't know.
For fuck's sake, like.
They're also great comedians. They just play the truth of it and we find it funny.
How's the new tune?
What?
That allows you to nail, I think, the comedy, but also get to the sadness.
Ben.
And they definitely didn't want to shy away from any of those sadder or trickier points. I think people really love them as a pairing, as I do, and I kind of wanted to explore getting them back together in a very different story, and you couldn't get them back together and do something lesser. You could do something very different, and I think that's what we've done.
But we're going from the top, yeah?
Yes, no.
Yeah.
Go back more, keep the horror, just a simple version of the horror.
Okay,
yeah.
Okay.
Cool.
I wanted all of the supporting characters to have their own singular lives.
A job offer, is it?
Every person in life is the lead actor in their own film.
You probably wouldn't ever want to, I don't know, fall in love with a boy like me, would you?
No, Dominic, I don't think so, love.
Oh, there goes that dream.
You should sort of treat all of the supporting characters that way.
It's a great cast. It's just a brilliant cast.
I see he doesn't talk to you no more.
Do.
Siobhán, played by Kerry Condon, is Pádraic's younger sister. We've been working together for like 22 years, I think.
Honestly, at this point, if it was a very small part, I would do it for Martin because he's such a good writer and I've worked with him for so many years. I've known him since I was 17.
This was very much written with her in mind, and I don't think, I know there wasn't anyone else who could have played it with a degree of integrity and intelligence and humour and sadness, I suppose, that she brought to it.
Colin, what the hell are you hoping for, like?
For a bit of peace, Siobhán, that's all. For a bit of peace, in my heart, like. You can understand that, can't you? Siobhán is one of the few figures of hope in this particular tale, but my God, like, did she bring a anger and frustration and clarity and kindness and so many different things to the role. It's about one boring man leaving another man alone, that's all.
One boring man, you're all feckin' boring. With your piddling grievances over nothing, you're all feckin' boring!
If we're saying we start the scene a teeny bit before we have already, so if the first thing is like that, and then straight after it's that. Dominic, played by Barry Keoghan. That was a very fun character to write. I'd wanted to work with Barry for a long time.
I've always wanted to work with Martin McDonagh. He's a genius. There's just so many layers, like a lot of tragedy, and it is funny, and it's not specifically one thing, and that's what he's great at.
What the hell was he hitting you with?
The kettle was the final thing. I wouldn't have minded, but for the spout.
One of the greats, he really is.
We're good at chatting, aren't we? Me and you.
There's an integrity to him and a darkness, but something that's very cinematic about Barry that I wanted to explore, and Barry plays it beautifully and heartbreakingly and comedically.
You're behaving awful unusual.
Rolling.
Ready? Background action. Action.
The policeman is played by Gary Lydon, who I'd worked with maybe 20 years ago in a play, and he was actually in a short film mine I made maybe 15 or 20 years ago, Six Shooter.
Martin McDonagh, you know what I mean? I love Martin's plays, like in his films. You know, I was honoured to be asked to audition. I just love his writing, like the dialogue is second to none.
Oh, hello there, Colin. Will I see you at John Joe's tonight for that pint you owe me?
I owe you no pint. You will, Pádraic.
Good man yourself.
The script as well is really beautifully written script, you know, it's like a piece of music.
They've asked for extra manpower for a couple of the executions. I've always wanted to see an execution, haven't you? Although, I'd have preferred the hanging.
It's just brilliant actors everywhere, just an incredible ensemble of actors doing amazing work everywhere. I'm just trying to keep up with everyone, really, to be honest with you. I mean, just amazing stuff going on left, right and centre.
There's a lovely little donkey in this story called Jenny, sort of another really good friend of Colin's character, Pádraic. And we got a beautiful miniature donkey to play Jenny, who was called Jenny in real life.
At the start, she was a bit overwhelmed. It's been a really new experience for her to be surrounded by all the equipment, but she's really settling into it now, and I was really happy with her today. We come in, she has a lot of different cues, whether it's verbal cues or hand signals, to go and do her behaviour, and then she'll come back to me and get a little treat after.
Good girl, well done.
The best donkey for the job. She nailed it.
Yeah, they love her. I think they're almost upstaging the actors. Yeah, they just steal the show, don't they?
Like every scene, every time she pops up in a film, I don't really listen to the actors anymore. It was like that on set too.
I am not putting my donkey outside when I'm sad.
Martin wrote this script, the calf is doing that, and then the dog comes up and gives the horse a lick, and then the donkey comes over and gives the dog a nuzzle. And you're just going, fucking were you smoking when you wrote that? Because it's impossible. And then lo and behold, the animals just did the most beautiful things.
I just didn't want to set a story like this in the modern day. There's almost some certain allegorical aspects to the division between these two men and the division between both sides in the Irish Civil War. The Irish Civil War is raging over on the mainland, so it's a story where a tiny little war is waging between two fellas at the same time as a bigger one is happening over there.
It's funny that the people on the island don't really give a shit about what's going on in the mainland.
Adding in the paper.
The Civil War still.
They're not really that bothered about the Civil War, and it's like they're a separate little country and separate little everything all unto themselves.
There's something a little insular about living on an island, and you see the same people and would usually go about life in the same way day after day. And that's kind of what was interesting about the start of this story, is that what happens when there's a rupture to that pleasant, placid, everyday life. I really wanted it not to be in a specific place, so hence a made-up island. So I wanted it to be something a little more mythical. So we explored each of the Aran Islands, and actually Inishmore, the largest of the three, ticked most of the boxes. So we shot there for 3 weeks.
So we decided on Inishmore quite early on. In the script, the laneways feature very prominently, and the small fields and the stone walls. And when you go looking for it, it's actually pretty unique to the Aran Islands, and we found some really good spots in Inishmore.
As a kid, my parents live in Galway along the coast, and you can actually see the Aran Islands from where they are. And Inishmore has, you know, for Irish people especially, a lot of mythical and literary associations. So I always was intrigued about setting something there.
And being, you know, Dun Aengus, up there on the horizon, you know, reaching for the sky all these millennia, and the most beautiful sunsets we had.
It was just like a dream. It is like a dream. And the views, oh God, they're extraordinary. Extraordinary.
The places that we have been lucky enough to inhabit for this short time we've spent together have really held the story together and have held our dreams and our disappointments and our fears and our need to allow the story breath and vastness for this ultimately really intimate kind of passion play to take place.
I've never made a period thing before, and I kind of was interested in that particularly. Hema's costumes are amazing, and it changes something. It really immediately lifts something from script. You can actually, like, physically see a character when they walk on set. They don't even have to start acting.
Traditionally, when we think about a period like the 1920s, we often kind of see it in black and white because we're looking at black and white photographs. Ireland at the time, the women's traditional dress, they wore red petticoats, and there was a much richer colour palette there. So we're using a lot of red, we're using yellow, we're using greens, we're using deep blues.
It was beautiful because we had to pick costumes that we imagined that Siobhán could have made herself, that showed that she was kind of thinking a little bit further than the people in the village. And then some of the costumes we thought might have been passed down from her mother.
Emer just came with ideas and designs and patterns and materials, and she was a big part in me creating Pádraic or finding Pádraic. I mean, it's just really stepping back in time in a beautiful but eerie way.
Colm's hat, it's a touch of an old-style Western in that, and yet it looks like a Sean Keating painting with the large brim. So you're crossing into worlds and creating your own kind of world.
We found a beautiful coast road to build the pub. So we didn't go looking for a pub. We went looking for the most beautiful spot to build a pub, and that worked out on Achill.
We were brave enough to build a pub here because it's literally on the sea and it's massively open to the elements. And then we decided to go for it. So we built our pub from scratch. We sat on the bench, looked at the view and thought, yeah, that's the view we'd like from our front door. So we orientated our pub door to look down the coastline along the Wild Atlantic Way. So what happens in the story is these two characters fall out. And so the idea was to have one long bar, a sort of two ends of the pub. One goes to one part of the pub, the other goes to the other, and it's a sort of standoff.
The subtlety of the design in terms of pushing the bar, as I say, into a more Western kind of a thing, but actually having feeling like a West of Ireland pub. It's a Western bar in every sense of the word. So the design has been amazing, really, really intuitive.
It's Ireland Western. John Ford references and Sergio Leone.
Maybe the period, 1923, just threw up all these ideas of the Western. Just shooting through doorways and that kind of John Fordian trope, I guess, was something that we were looking for. This idea of these two almost lone gunmen, in a way, falling out and getting into tiffs at the local saloon.
If you don't stop talking to me, and if you don't stop bothering me, I have a set of shears at home, and I'll take one of my fingers off with them. Each day you bother me more, another I'll take off, and I'll give you until you see sense enough to stop, or until I have no fingers left.
There is something about that in me, to go to something self-inflicted. It's a complicated and complex and worrying choice of Colm's, cutting his fingers off, but I do kind of understand it. That is the question of, in some ways, of life as an artist. Do you devote yourself totally to it? Is the work the most important thing? And does it not matter who gets hurt in the process? It's a debate in the film, which isn't really answered. It's a debate in me that's never really been answered. To be a writer or a filmmaker, you know, you always think, are you wasting time generally, you know, by going on holiday or watching football or whatever. And that's something interesting to be explored. I never know where a story's going to end when I start it. I've never plot things out, never do a treatment or anything like that. The script, for me, it's all about the character and the dialogue and the situations. It's not at that stage about images, but I like the cinematic and I want films to be not just about character and dialogue. So the storyboarding process is a major second phase of storytelling. And I usually just go off on my own for 2 or 3 months with the script and do that. Ben's brilliant. This is our third film together. He loves cinema. He loves the beautiful image and he tolerates the storyboards. And with Mark Tildesley, the production designer, because of COVID, the three of us were in a house together in Galway a year before we started shooting with Peter Cohen, the first AD. It was like the perfect time to go through every single scene, every storyboard, and find out what the most cinematic way of doing that could be. And you don't usually have that time, definitely not a year before shooting starts. The delay allowed us to make it more cinematic. I think it really helped. I don't like films or plays or stories generally that are wrapped up in a perfect bow. I like films that you can watch repeatedly. I feel it should be like going back to a novel. Whatever ending you're offered up, I think, should be perfect in its own sense, even if it leaves you with a lot of questions. I think those questions are as interesting as being spoon-fed an ending.
I always love going to a movie and coming back and having a proper barney afterwards about the significance of it and at what point did you lose and gain sympathy. And again, coming back to Martin's writing, it's the ability to be able to mix and match all that stuff. You don't get a hero and a villain. We're all heroes and villains.
The themes that are explored of fidelity and friendship, of separation and loneliness, of sadness and death and grief and violence, and all these themes are all very human themes that we can all relate to and that we have all been touched by.
I really wanted to send an audience out really sad to get a sad truth about this story, about Ireland at that time maybe, about life. I think there are twists and turns in the story that I hope an audience won't see coming. And I usually like that kind of thing too.